I am Karen Keneally. I'm in the Department of Human Genetics at Emory University. This is my second CGI. This is better, right? This is my second CGI. At my first one, I gave a talk about statistical methods for analysis of DNA methylation sequencing data. This year, I'm going to do something a little bit different and talk about some new work that I'm excited about in clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential and DNA methylation. Just to give a brief overview of what I'll be talking about, I'll start with a brief introduction to both DNA methylation and to clonal hematopoiesis, and then we'll combine these together in an epigenome-wide association study. We'll perform this in human blood samples from the TOPMED. They were generated by TOPMED for the cardiovascular health study, and we'll replicate that in the ERIC study. Blood isn't always the ideal tissue to study. It's pretty close for what we're studying, but there are even better cell types, and so we'll bring in some external data from relevant cell types. We'll integrate it together to do some enrichment and functional annotation analyses that'll help us interpret what we find in the epigenome-wide association study. We'll go further into the literature to interpret this a little bit more and draw some conclusions. And an overarching theme here is going to be that generating new data requires resources that we don't always have, especially when you're junior. But there's really a wealth of existing genomic data resources out there. We can take advantage of these and integrate them in new ways to answer new questions, and this can complement what we learn from experimental approaches. And so as promised, DNA methylation, it is an epigenetic mechanism involving the attachment of a methyl group, or CH3, to a single nucleotide, usually a cytosine, as in the picture here. So here's a cytosine, and here it is with a methyl group added to its 5 position. This occurs mainly on it occurs mainly on cytosines that are followed by guanines, and so these are known by CpG dinucleotides, as we see in the cartoon here. Here's 2 CGs with little methyl groups attached. The methyl groups are attached through a reaction that's catalyzed by a family of proteins called DNA methyltransferases, as shown in this image here. And there's 3 main DNA methyltransferases. DNMT1 is generally responsible for maintenance methylation. So when a cell divides, it makes sure that the methylation patterns of that cell are faithfully passed on to its daughter cells. This is called mitotic inheritance. The other 2, DNMT3A and 3B, are responsible for de novo methylation, the addition of methyl groups that weren't there before. And which one is important seems to vary depending on context, like when and what tissue. The DNA methyl groups can also be removed through demethylation, and this is generally catalyzed through with the help of a family of TET proteins. These catalyze the reaction of methyl cytosine to hydroxymethyl cytosine, as shown here. So a hydroxy group has been added. And this leads to demethylation, especially during cell division, where the hydroxymethyl group isn't recognized as methyl group, so as a methyl group, so it's not passed on anymore. One of the reasons we care about DNA methylation is its role in gene regulation. Every single CpG site in the genome is not regulating gene expression. The role is actually very context dependent. Actually, in us, most of our CpG sites are probably methylated most of the time and aren't doing very much. But there are exceptions to this. One important exception is these CpG-rich regions. Here's an example of a CpG-rich region. There's a lot of CpGs in this little piece of the genome. These are known as CpG islands. They're generally located in promoter regions and generally unmethylated. As you see here, the open circles mean unmethylated CpG. The filled circles are methylated CpG. The surrounding regions tend to have even higher regulatory potential. The shores are the sort of 2Kb regions flanking the islands, and then there's things called shelves that are the 2Kb regions flanking the shores. And those are more variable and probably the most likely to be regulatory. But the canonical view of DNA methylation is that methylation of promoter regions can lead to the silencing of genes, as in this cartoon. So here is the unmethylated DNA strand. Assuming this is a promoter region, the gene would be thought of as free to be expressed. When it becomes methylated, gene expression may be silenced and transcription is repressed. So, and one thing I should note is that promoter regions are not the only interesting regulatory regions. There are definitely other regions with regulatory DNA methylation potential, especially enhancer regions. The gene bodies can also be important too. Another role of DNA methylation is in cell fate determination. So Waddington, who sort of developed epigenetics back, he developed the idea of epigenetics back in the 1940s, was also the first to propose this model shown here, where the epigenetic mechanisms help establish cellular identity. So the idea is that we start with a stem cell, and as the marble rolls down the slope, epigenetic changes may occur. And depending on what the changes are, the marble may go this way toward the lymphoid lineage or this way toward the myeloid lineage. And then when it gets here, more epigenetic changes happen, and that determines whether it becomes a neutrophil or a monocyte. And the idea behind this, the slope, the downward slope, is that once you get to the bottom, you're stuck. This is the cell that you are. You can't go back to being a stem cell. We know that's not really true anymore with induced pluripotent stem cells, but this wasn't available in the 1940s or 50s. Impressively, this model that was proposed back in the 40s and 50s, when we didn't have that many, we weren't able to look at this in very many different ways, this continues to be supported to this day by the modern day studies. Here's an example from 2012. This is just bulk array-based data, no fancy single-cell data, but in this project, they sorted whole blood into different components, and within each component, they looked at the methylation profiles, and you can see that each of these components has its own methylation profile. The interesting thing is that when they did hierarchical clustering, the little tree that was produced really resembles the actual lineage of these blood cells. If you're an immunologist, you would recognize that. Also, the lymphoid cells are down here, the myeloid cells are up here. It kind of tracks the lineage pretty well. And this is using technology from 10 years ago. I think the single cell studies, if they're done in blood, will show us even more interesting clustering. And that brings us into our, now that we're talking about hematopoiesis, that brings us into our discussion of clonal hematopoiesis. And so what this word means, if you haven't seen it before, is it really just means to make blood. It's the making of blood. So we have these stem cells that live in our bone marrow. They're called hematopoietic stem cells. And they are responsible for making all of our different blood cells, including the red blood cells and the platelets, but also the white blood cells or immune cells, which we're going to be talking about most of the time today. And so again, we have our myeloid lineage and our lymphoid lineage, and within these there are different cell types. But it all starts with hematopoietic stem cells, which are differentiating so they can keep replacing 10 billion white blood cells every day. In addition to making new cells, they have to also kind of replenish themselves and keep the population of hematopoietic stem cells going, so there's also this little self-renewal step seen here. And as far as self-renewing, each hematopoietic stem cell will divide between every 2 to 20 months, and this is to balance out loss of the stem cells through cell death, senescence, and differentiation into downstream progeny cells. And this leads to a pretty stable population in adults. In most of us, we probably have between 50,000 and 200,000 hematopoietic stem cells in our bone marrow at any given time. And so during the cell division process, mutations are acquired. They expect about 1 to 2 per cell division. And so as with any kind of division like this, it starts to resemble a phylogenetic tree, where we can see, like, if we looked at all of these cells, they would have different patterns of mutations that would allow us to kind of trace their lineage. And so the cells can be analyzed using phylogenetic inference or other population genetic approaches. And that's actually how we know what the starting population of hematopoietic stem cells is, between 50,000 and 200,000, from these kinds of studies. Like any population, these populations of cells are subject to selection. As far as what would provide a selective advantage for these hematopoietic stem cells, one way would be this increased propensity to self-renew or make copies of itself instead of differentiating. If they could just make lots of copies, as in this cartoon, if you get something, so a mutation giving it this selective advantage is called a driver mutation. If a cell acquires a driver mutation that allows it to make lots of copies of itself, you might imagine that it becomes a disproportionate part of your blood. It becomes basically a clone, and so this is the clonality that we'll be talking about. And when it happens in blood, when clonality happens in blood, it's called clonal hematopoiesis, when it happens at the hematopoietic stem cell level. And this is where a single lineage is contributing disproportionately to the population of blood cells. So the fact that hematopoietic stem cells could be clonal was first detected in the context of X inactivation. If you haven't seen X inactivation before, the idea is that those of us with two X chromosomes, we need dosage compensation so women aren't expressing twice as much X chromosome genes as men. And so at a very early stage in development, one of the two X chromosomes is suppressed into a little thing called a barrel body where the genes aren't expressed. And this happens randomly. So about half the cells will have one X chromosome repressed and the other half will have the other. And it looks sort of like this on this side of, and it's probably a calico cat because half of these cells are orange and half are black. And this probably represents there's a gene for orange versus black fur that occurs on the X chromosome. And so this is normal that we would have half of the cells in our body with one X repressed and the other half with the other. But it was noticed in the 1960s that they had this monoallelic expression looking more like this or maybe entirely one kind of X chromosome in the blood of patients with chronic myeloid leukemia. In the 1990s, they noticed that these patterns became increasingly skewed in older individuals. So in a young individual, you might have 50-50 of each kind of X chromosome like you would expect, but as people got older, you would get more like 60-40, and it would then 70-30, and it would keep going. And so this was kind of like the early detection of clonal hematopoiesis. These were healthy older individuals where they saw this. So today in the 21st century, so this was looking at just the chromosome level. It was discovered the X chromosome because we couldn't go in easily and look at individual mutations. Today with high coverage sequencing data, we can look at individual somatic mutations. And so through these studies, driver mutations have been identified in some important genes, including DNA methyltransferase 3A, TET2, a couple of others, AXXL1, JAK2, and many others that are frequently found also in hematological cancers, which makes sense because this is also this clonality is also the way cancer begins. In addition to finding these in cancer, but these mutations are also found in healthy individuals at lower levels. And at this point, it's uncertain what might happen. It might progress to cancer in the future. It might not, but it might lead to other phenotypic differences. And for that reason, it's been termed clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential, abbreviated as CHIP, because I don't think the field of biology uses CHIP for enough different things yet, right? So now we have another one. So CHIP. So if I refer to CHIP, this is the only way I'm going to refer to CHIP in this talk. And I apologize for any confusion. So large-scale studies of prospectively collected individuals with sequencing data have enabled the study of CHIP somewhat recently. And that's because deep coverage is needed to accurately call these somatic mutations because they're present at low levels. They're not present at the same levels we might see them in cancer. They might be present at just 5% or 10% in individuals, in an individual's blood sample. In addition to that, not that many people have CHIP. It's generally, in most of you, it's probably very low because it's low in younger people. So large samples are needed to identify sufficient numbers of individuals with CHIP to do a reasonable study. And I mentioned the relationship with age. The first whole exome studies of CHIP were done in 2014, and they all found similar patterns where CHIP prevalence is very low in the first 50 or 60 years of life, and then it begins to increase such that about 10% of individuals over 70 harbor a CHIP mutation, and almost 20% of individuals over 90 have a CHIP mutation. And so it's not a huge number of people, but as you get older, it starts to, it becomes more prevalent. In addition, so CHIP is also associated with increased disease risk. So these whole exome studies also showed that it associates with the risk for blood cancers, which again is not that surprising. So you can see it in this survival plot here. It's actually a very large hazard ratio. So there's quite an increase in risk. And this makes sense because these mutations, the driver mutations themselves are not sufficient to yield blood cancer, but the acquisition of additional pathogens or mutations on the clone will drive a progression to hematological cancer. There's also an increase in mortality. The hazard ratio isn't quite as large, but this increase is probably in part due to the increased risk for cancer, also due to increased risk for other diseases, such as cardiovascular disease, myocardial infarction, stroke, coronary artery disease. So CHIP is definitely a public health concern. Because it's new in the last decade, there are a lot of studies kind of actively pursuing this. And there's a lot that still remains unknown about the underlying mechanisms. I mentioned that we have some idea of how it progresses to blood cancer through the acquisition of passenger mutations, although there's still a lot that's unknown. Less is known about why it leads to increased risk for cardiovascular disease, and so this is an active area of inquiry. And then another thing that we don't know yet is, why do these particular driver mutations result in the self-renewal phenotype? Like, by exactly what mechanism does this happen? And a lot of what we do know so far comes from experimental studies. It's these genes have been knocked out in mice, and you can learn a lot from that. But an important question behind today's talk is, what can we learn about these mechanisms by taking advantage of the existing population-based data resources? And an advantage of these resources is, unlike these mouse studies, which are generally small due to costs, there are already these extremely large cohorts of sequenced individuals that we can examine. That's an advantage, the size. Some disadvantages are that, unlike the experimental mice, where half of them are probably in the experimental group, there are going to be very few individuals, even in these large cohort studies, who harbor CHIP mutations. And within these individuals, only a small proportion of their blood is going to carry the CHIP mutation, unlike a knockout mouse where the gene would just be gone. So today's focus is going to go towards that question. We'll start with an epigenome-wide association study of CHIP and DNA methylation. And our hypothesis here is that, given the common roles of the two most common CHIP genes as regulators of DNA methylation, we expect CHIP to associate with DNA methylation and believe that these mutations may have unique, they may each have a unique DNA methylation signature. Assuming this is true, our plan was to functionally annotate these signatures to try to better understand them. And our hypothesis there was that this examination would provide insight into what the mechanisms might be underlying this relationship, like how these driver mutations lead to the self-renewal phenotype that we see in CHIP. So just a little bit of background on the data. I mentioned that we're using cardiovascular health study data that was generated by TopMed. TopMed was this NHLBI-funded effort to perform whole genome sequencing and other omics in these large cohort studies that are very richly phenotyped. And through TopMed, whole genome sequencing study has been performed with high coverage, now in over 100,000 blood samples. And the age range of these is quite wide and skews older, which is nice because it's older individuals who tend to have CHIP, and so it's good for a CHIP study, although that wasn't the only reason for TopMed. CHIP has now been called for these 100,000 samples, and they identified over 4,000 individuals who harbored a CHIP mutation. And you can see from this graph here that there's a wide range of variant allele frequency. The variant allele frequency is the proportion of blood cells that have a CHIP mutation. And you can see it goes all the way from about 5%, which is the lower limit of detection with this coverage level, up to close to 100%, but the vast majority of individuals are down in here, so around maybe 10% variant allele frequency. And the majority have less than 20%. If you look at the mutations themselves, there were almost 5,000 different mutations, like different point mutations or otherwise identified. Most of these were coding mutations that were in the 8 genes that were most commonly mutated in the whole exome sequencing studies that were performed earlier. And so again, we see our DNA methyltransferase 3A and TET2. We also see another epigenetic modifier, ASXL1, and some genes that are also present in cancers, especially blood cancers. Similar to the whole exome studies, an increasing prevalence of CHIP with age was noted. And here we can see it was very consistent across cohorts, almost remarkably consistent. And like the whole exome sequencing, it's quite low. And you can see that the prevalence is quite low in the first 50 years of life, but then it vastly increases. And if we live to be 100, about 30% of us will have CHIP mutations at that point, apparently. OK, so that background brings us to our epigenome-wide association study for CHIP. And at this point, I should mention my great collaborators at the Broad Institute. Pradeep Natarajan was very instrumental in the calling of CHIP in those 100,000 TopMed samples. And Mesbah is his postdoc and is the first author on our manuscript. So he also led the epigenome-wide association study I'm about to tell you about. And so the goal of this EWAS, or epigenome-wide association study, is to identify the DNA methylation signatures associated with the presence of CHIP and then the presence of driver mutations specifically in DNA methyltransferase or in 3A or in TET2. And if we find these signatures that are associated with CHIP, we're curious whether they're going to vary by the driver mutation type, whether the signatures are going to give us information about the underlying mechanisms leading to the self-renewal phenotype, And also if they help explain the relationships between CHIP and phenotypes like coronary artery disease or aging, although I'm not going to have time to get into that in today's talk. So our discovery and replication samples, our discovery sample was the cardiovascular health study. We had 582 individuals, which is not huge, although we had about 400 with two time points, so we had a total of 1,000 samples to work with. And an advantage of this sample is that it's a much older age range. The average age was 73.6. And so the prevalence of CHIP was reasonably high in this sample, almost 15%. Our replication sample was larger but younger. And so we had 2,600 individuals, although the prevalences of CHIP are much lower. So the power for our replication and our discovery sample is probably not all that different. A little bit about epigenome-wide association studies. The idea here is that we use microarrays to measure DNA methylation at single CpGs across the genome, at single CpG resolution. And the Illumina has been producing methylation arrays over the years. The two most recent ones can measure the proportion of DNA methylated at either almost 500,000 sites or almost 1,000,000 sites. We're using the second most recent one because these were collected several years ago. And unlike a genome-wide association study, where the conventional GWAS are now looking at tens of thousands or maybe even hundreds of thousands of samples, conventional EWAS are typically measuring DNA methylation in hundreds or thousands of samples. We haven't quite gotten that large yet, but actually TopMed is collecting DNA methylation, so they're going to be larger soon. And so the idea behind an epigenome-wide association study is we analyze each site individually, kind of like in a GWAS. At each site, we fit a regression model to modeling methylation as the outcome to assess whether an individual's methylation levels are correlated with our trait of interest. And here's an example from an EWAS of aging that we did about 10 years ago. So here are two sites that were associated with aging. Methylation is on the y-axis. It ranges from 0 to 1 because we're looking at the proportion of blood cells that are methylated. And on the x-axis, we have age. And you can see this site shows a somewhat linear increase in methylation with age. It's subtle, but it's consistent. And then this site shows a somewhat linear decrease in methylation with age. And as in a GWAS, we would do this for 500,000 or 1,000,000 sites. And then perhaps we would have a way of plotting our results in the form of negative log p-values along the chromosomes in a Manhattan plot like this one. And this Manhattan plot is bidirectional because we're interested in CpGs that are showing increases in DNA methylation with age and those showing decreases in DNA methylation with age. And so this scatter plot here might correspond to a single point on the graph, perhaps this one over here, and this one might correspond to this point over here. And so we have this Manhattan plot. Anything that's significant in a Bonferroni level of significance is colored either red or green. And if you've looked at Manhattan plots for GWAS, compared to those, this would look very strange because we wouldn't expect to see our entire genome correlated with any phenotype. If we did, we would know something was really wrong with our analysis. But in studies of DNA methylation or gene expression, it's much more common to see vast sets of genes or sites that are dysregulated if it's an important biological phenotype like age. Or perhaps another phenotype would be if we had done an EWAS for cell type composition, we might have seen a similar outcome. If we do EWAS for a disease, we probably wouldn't see so much association across the genome. But that's just a little bit of context. Any questions so far? Okay. Oh, yeah. 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 Sorry, I meant to say that I should have said 4,000 individuals with one or more CHIP mutations because individuals can have multiple mutations. So some individuals will have two or even three mutations.
And are those individuals
special in some way? The answer to both of those questions is probably, but I don't know for sure. And I have some methylation data. It's not in the talk, but I have some methylation data I can show you on those individuals if you're interested. Come see me after if you are. But that's a good question. Thank you. I think the answer to your question is probably yes. Yes, next question. Yeah.
Are there any copy number variations in CHIP? Is it mostly SNVs?
No, there are definitely copy number variations. I should have included a figure showing the different mutation types, and I didn't.
Okay.
Yeah. Other questions? Okay, so we performed an epigenome-wide association study for clonal hematopoiesis. And we did this using a linear mixed model that modeled DNA methylation as the outcome. And our independent variable of interest was going to be CHIP, either the presence of CHIP or the presence of a DNA methyltransferase 3A or a TET2 mutation. We did three separate EWAS. We had a set of covariates that included age and age squared, as well as sex, batch, a set of cell type proportions, which we estimated, and I'll talk in a minute about how we did that. Our cardiovascular health study, our discovery analysis was longitudinal, so we also adjusted for time point and included individual random effects to model the correlation between individuals due to the repeated measures. And both of our discovery and replication study included separate cohorts of African American and European American individuals, so we performed our EWAS separately within ancestral groups and then used the METAL software to combine via meta-analysis. A little bit about cell type proportions. I know this has been alluded to in other talks already. So from DNA methylation data, cell type proportions can be estimated through two approaches. There are reference-based approaches and reference-free approaches. And both of those approaches stem from the same underlying model where the observed DNA methylation we see, which is this matrix that we're calling Y here, is sort of the matrix product of these two other matrices, M, which is let's say Y is a blood sample, if we were able to actually look at the different components of the blood sample and see those DNA methylation profiles for each cell type and put them into a matrix, that's what M is. Omega here is just the proportion, so omega here is our matrix, it's the different samples we have, or specimens. Each individual in the study probably has a different mix of cell types. Here we have, on this axis, we have six different cell types. And so omega contains the information on what the proportions of the different cell types are within each individual. And the product of the cell type specific profiles and the actual cell type proportions would give us the DNA methylation data. That's the model underlying these methods to adjust for cell type proportion. And I think people have alluded to the reference-free type approaches for deconvolution of expression data. And if we were doing a reference-free approach, this would be similar. You would do you could do a non-negative matrix factorization or some kind of other approach to estimate omega, which is our goal. We want to estimate what the cell type proportions are from the methylation data that we have. So with blood DNA methylation data, it's actually very common to use a reference-based approach. And the reason for this is that we have good reference data already for six common blood cell types. And this actually comes from the 2012 study that I showed you earlier, which was done on the same, or an earlier version of the same microarray. And so we can use that as our reference data and perform a reference-based approach. And the basic idea behind most of the reference-based approaches, including the original one that we're using by Hausman, the basic idea is very simple. It's essentially a two-step process where you would start with your reference data. Let's assume Y is our reference data. And with the reference data, the reason they're reference data is because we know what all of the different cell type proportions are. So in this matrix, we know that, we know what kind of cell this is, we know what kind of cell this is, and so it's 100% whatever cell type this is. So we would know what omega is. We could then regress Y onto omega to get an estimate of the cell type profiles for each cell type. We could then take the estimate of M over to our data. We could regress our data matrix on M, and that would give us an estimate of omega in our data. And we could use these estimated cell type proportions that we've just gotten for our data. We could then put them into our epigenome-wide association study as covariates. And that's what we ended up doing. Okay, so there are a couple of possible limitations to our proposed EWAS. So the DNA methylation was measured in bulk blood samples. One standard limitation of this blood is a mixture of different cell types, and we are adjusting for this by covarying for these estimated cell type proportions. There's another source of heterogeneity in this study, and that is that only a small proportion of the cells in our sample are going to have the CHIP mutation. And these are the variant allele frequencies, the distributions of variant allele frequency in our sample for both CHS and ERIC for each of the two mutations. And you can see that they're all like just around or under 15%. So it's not huge. So what this means is if there's a unique DNA methylation profile associated with CHIP, it's the cells that have CHIP are going to be diluted by the cells that don't have CHIP. So we're probably going to see a diluted version of this methylation profile. And so this could potentially reduce our power to see anything. And so a question before we did this was, would this limit what we're able to see? And when we went, when we performed at UAS, we so this Manhattan plot shows that we actually saw that the presence of CHIP associates with both decreasing and increasing DNA methylation at a large number of sites. So over 5,000 sites showed significant, basically Bonferroni significant decreases in methylation as a result of having CHIP, and nearly 2,000 sites showed increasing methylation. And I guess that was according to an FDR criterion. If we looked at the Bonferroni criterion, there were still over 500 sites that were significant according to this step-down Bonferroni criterion that we used. And 66% of our FDR significant sites, of these like 7,000-ish sites up here, replicated using a rather conservative replication criterion in ERIC. And so that was interesting, even given the limitations of our study. And one thing we saw right away is, well, we see these effects in both directions. Like for the over here, we have a peak of CPG sites that are showing decreases in methylation with CHIP. Over here, we have a peak that's showing increased. Are we seeing a mixture of the different types of mutations? Because some of these individuals have DNA methyltransferase 3A CHIP. Others have CHIP with a TET2 mutation. Others may have CHIP due to a third kind of mutation. So we thought we'd break it down a little bit and look at the people with mutations in one particular gene. And we started with DNA methyltransferase 3A. And so here's the Manhattan plot for DNA methyltransferase 3A. Here we see almost nothing but decreasing methylation with CHIP, with just a few exceptions. So at over 4,000 sites, we saw decreasing DNA methylation with CHIP, and not quite 100 sites showed increasing methylation at an FTR criterion. Our most associated site was down here. This is in a gene that's been highly expressed in uncommitted hematopoietic cells, and as well as acute myeloid leukemia. And so it was interesting to see this genome-wide decrease with DNA methyltransferase, because we know that normally what the DNA methyltransferase does is add new methyl groups. The loss of it, we're not going to be adding methyl groups anymore, so we should see a decrease. This is consistent with what we expect biologically. So it's not, maybe it's not surprising, but it was, you don't always see what you expect to see. So in that sense, it was surprising. When we looked at TET, we saw the reverse. And this also makes sense because the role of TET is normally to assist with demethylation, and without TET, we kind of the methylation sticks around, and so you should see increases in methylation due to TET. But again, these were in individuals, a small number of individuals had TET. Actually, the replication was hard because we had very few individuals with TET2 in a replication sample. But even so, we still saw these patterns, even though the people had probably about 15%, the people who did have TET had about 15% variant allele frequency. But that was still enough to show these rather robust associations with TET2. And so we have now this interesting pattern of opposing patterns of association with the two mutations. And so with these volcano plots, we have the effect size on the x-axis. So the right-hand side shows positive association, the left this side shows negative. And we have the negative log 10 p-values on the y-axis. And so you can see the difference in direction quite strikingly. Points over the dotted line are those that were significant in our discovery analysis. The colored points were also significant in the replication analysis. And as I said, this opposing pattern does make sense given the roles of these gene products. It's still surprising given our small number of CHIP carriers, mostly with low variant allele frequency. Like I said earlier, this is not the same as a knockout mouse study where you would have maybe half of your mice would have the phenotype and the phenotype would be complete. The gene would be completely gone. But it's interesting that these volcano plots do appear to recapitulate similar volcano plots that were observed recently in a knockout mouse study. They assessed methylation quite differently than we did, but you still see this pattern where TET2 is mostly associated with increasing methylation and DNA methyltransferase 3A is mostly associated with decreasing methylation. So we'd like to investigate these profiles a little bit further. And one question would be, we have CPG sites going up with TET2 mutations, CPG sites going down with DNA methyltransferase 3A mutations. Are these the same sites? Like they just go in one direction or the other? It turns out they're not really. There's not, looking at the sets of replicated CPG sites, there's only 23 out of thousands that overlap. And although 23 is greater than what we would expect by chance, it's still not very much. These profiles are essentially distinct, and we're going to treat them mostly as distinct profiles. In our next step, which is going to be functional annotation of these profiles, just to try to better understand their regulatory potential, what they might be regulating, how, like why they're different, what it means. And so again, we have these two mostly distinct sets of associated CpGs that are associated in opposite directions. We're curious about how they differ. One question, and why they differ, really. And one idea that we initially had about why they might differ is something, it corresponds to something that I'd seen earlier in the field of aging, and a similar phenomenon is seen in cancer, where the CpG sites in aging or cancer that are in low DNA methylation regions, such as islands, these are the ones that show increased methylation in aging and increases in cancer. And similarly, those showing decreased DNA methylation in aging or cancer tend to be in regions that start out with very high methylation. And just to show, kind of to show that in pictures, here's our Manhattan plot showing the sites associated with aging that I showed you earlier, where the red sites are positively associated and then the green sites are negatively associated with aging. So all of these studies are performed using these microarrays. And I hadn't yet showed you the distribution of the methylation at the CpG sites on the microarrays, but this is what it looks like. It's a bimodal distribution. So a lot of the sites are unmethylated, and a lot of the sites are fully methylated, and there's not that many sites that are in between. And this is somewhat typical of what you'd see if you looked at the entire genome and not just what's on the array. It's a little bit different, but it's still bimodal. And so this gives us an example of what the distribution of methylation generally looks like. And the question is, are these red sites or green sites that are associated with aging different in their distribution? And the answer is yes. The CpG sites showing decreased methylation in aging, as I mentioned, tend to be those with high DNA methylation. It's very striking. And the opposite pattern is observed for those showing increased methylation with aging. They start out very low. And interestingly, this is the pattern that we would see if it was completely stochastic. Like, if you just started randomly making things change, the CpG sites that are already high have nowhere to go but down. The CpG sites that are low have nowhere to go but up. Everything goes towards entropy. And this is kind of consistent with what other things we know about aging. So it doesn't mean that the DNA methylation pattern with aging is stochastic. There's evidence that it's not, but it's consistent with what we would see if it is stochastic. And you might have remembered that the low DNA methylation regions tend to be on islands. We had talked about this earlier. And so similar to that, if we look at enrichment for CpG islands, we see a similar pattern. We see that the increasing sites tend to overwhelmingly be located on islands. The decreasing sites show a big depletion for islands. And so one question would be, are we going to see these same patterns for the increasing sites with TET2 and the decreasing sites with DNA methyltransferase? Like if we put TET2 over here and DNA methyltransferase over here, would we see a pattern that looks like this? It seems like we might, but we really don't. So here is what the enrichment pattern looks like if we put, so the TET2 increasing sites are now over here, the TET2 decreasing sites are over here. And I should have said in the middle is what the distribution of islands and shelves and shores and open sea looks like on most of the sites in the array. But you can see that on sites that are associated with either kind of chip here are very depleted for islands. Very few of them are on, a lot of them are in these open sea regions where it's just kind of outside the whole island shore region. A lot of them are in shores and shelves, and these are regions that have been shown to be regulatory. So the information that we're getting here is that these sites are probably enriched for regulatory regions, but we're not seeing any kind of difference between the two profiles. And that's what we were hoping to kind of help this would help us understand, but we don't see that. And then back to this pattern of distribution of the methylation, of the initial methylation levels. We saw this in aging. We saw a very striking difference between decreasing sites and increasing sites. Are we going to see anything like this for CHIP? What do you guys think? No, we don't. So this is the distribution of methylation at the sites that are associated with DNA methyltransferase 3A, and this is the distribution for TET2. And they're really almost the same distribution. Their means are 0.575 and 0.555. There's a lot of sites, so if we did a t-test, they would be significantly different, but they're nothing like the striking differences that we saw with aging. So it doesn't look like it's explained by this pattern, this entropy-like pattern. It looks like it's probably something else. So they seem to have like a similar starting point. I should mention that these methylation averages are taken from a set of younger subjects who are unlikely to have CHIP. So if we're seeing things starting from the same distribution, these are the DNA methylation 3A ones are decreasing, the TET2 ones are increasing. Like, where are they going? What are they diverging toward? And what are the kind of actual effects of these changes that we're seeing? And so this is what we're hoping to find out. One thing to notice, So these two distributions, they're kind of in the middle of the distribution, whereas overall, not that many CpGs are in the middle of the distribution like this. So it seemed a little weird that these were, and we were wondering why. One thing to consider is that we're looking at averages in blood. And blood is a mixture of different cell types. And so perhaps we're seeing something in the middle because it's an average of two more extreme things. So we tried splitting it up into the two main lineages of blood, the myeloid and the lymphoid lineage, using these averages are taken from another source of external reference data, the whole genome bisulfite sequencing data generated through the Blueprint project. Here we see that there are, so the myeloid cells, they're both a little bit lower. The lymphoid cells, they're both higher. The TET2 are actually a little bit higher than the DNA methyltransferase 3 in this case. And so they're starting to separate a little bit. And maybe if we looked at all of the individual cell types, we'd find ones that show even more separation. One thing to consider, though, we're looking at the different components of whole blood, and that's nice. But are these what we really care about? Because these mutations are happening in hematopoietic stem cells. Like, so this might be the thing that we care the most about. Maybe it would be interesting if we could look at what the distributions look like in the hematopoietic stem cells. And the good news is that we can, because Blueprint collected those as well. And so we're adding these here. And this is interesting, because now we're starting to see a difference in the average methylation levels of these two sets of CpG sites. So now the DNA methyltransferase 3 ones are kind of low, and the TET2 ones are pretty high. And so now we're seeing a pattern that's interesting. The sites that are the DNA methyltransferase associated sites that are associated with decreasing DNA methylation in blood are low in hematopoietic stem cells. And the sites, the TET2 associated sites that are associated with increasing methylation in blood are high in hematopoietic stem cells. So it seems like in both cases, having a CHIP mutation is making the blood DNA methylation patterns look a little bit more like the stem cell DNA methylation patterns. They're making the blood cells look more stem-like, which is cool. And it supports a previously suggested model of DNA methyltransferase 3A that came from a study that showed that knockout of this gene impairs methylation, leading to maintenance of self-renewal instead of differentiation. And the idea here in this model that they propose is that methylation in a normal, healthy mouse that's not knocked out, methylation is repressing. So here we have stem cell-specific genes. Methylation comes along and represses those, telling them to shut themselves off. It's time to divide. And so they still self-renew and produce a few cells for posterity, but they're mostly dividing and making new blood cells. When you have knockout, the knocked out cells, the cells without DNA methyltransferase 3A, the methylation doesn't come and turn off these hematopoietic stem cells. And so this cell just keeps self-renewing to its heart's content. The differentiation doesn't happen as much. You can see by these thin dotted lines that it's still happening, but it's not happening as much. And one of the things they point out is that of the few knocked out stem cells that do differentiate, their progeny are showing incomplete methylation and only partial repression of the stem genes. And so you can see that this methylation profile, these are B cells, these are all the components of blood here. In the B cells, the methylation profile of the knocked out cell looks different than the methylation profile in the control. In fact, it looks more like a stem cell. So it seems like their knockout model is seeing something similar to what we just described, where the downstream blood cells look more stem-like as a result of the mutation in the hematopoietic stem cell. And so what are these profiles trying to tell us? We've kind of learned something now about the DNA methyltransferase 3A profile, maybe not as much about the TET2 profile yet. But we'd like to further investigate this, especially if we can do it in external data using hematopoietic stem cells. And so a few additional studies we're going to do here are to assess whether these profiles are enriched for regions that have accessible chromatin in stem cells versus other blood cells. We're going to look at gene expression profiles in stem cells, regions associated specifically with stem cell reprogramming, and then we'll do kind of a hypothesis-free gene ontology analysis at the end. So we first looked at whether these CHIP-associated CpG sets were enriched for regions of chromatin accessibility. And we did this by looking at enrichment for DNase-1 hypersensitive regions, or DHS regions, in different cell types obtained from the ENCODE project. We use that. There's already a tool designed. The eForge tool is designed to identify these cell-specific signals using our particular array data. They do a binomial test that assesses whether there's greater overlap than expected with these DHS hotspots by comparing our sets to 1,000 randomly generated genomic context match sets that they create for us. And so when we do this, we actually see that both of our sets of CpG sites, the DNA methylate transferase 3A and the TET2 associated sets, both of them are associated for DHS regions. The odds ratio is greater than one most of the time. This seems to be the baseline over here. It seems like the DNA methyltransferase 3A profiles are especially enriched for regions that are accessible in hematopoietic stem cells. The TET2 profiles are highly enriched for regions that are accessible in monocytes, which jives with literature I've seen showing that the TET2 mutations lead to an enhancement of the myeloid lineage. We next looked for enrichment of the hematopoietic stem cell gene expression signatures, and we looked at three different signatures here using different sources of external reference data. We looked at a set of marker genes for stem cells identified from single-cell RNA-seq data generated by the Human Cell Atlas from bone marrow tissue. There was a mouse study from actually over a decade ago where they identified a hematopoietic stem cell fingerprint based on 373 genes that are uniquely expressed in murine hematopoietic stem cells. And we also looked at another mouse study that identified 36 transcription factors and other genes that were they identified as reprogramming factors based on their expression in mouse hematopoietic stem cells. And so here we just did simple Fisher's exact tests, which really get you a long way. And these are the odds ratios from those Fisher's tests and p-values. So what you can see among the DNA methyltransferase 3 associated CpG sites is that for the first two, for the HSC marker genes from humans and mice, we see a surprisingly similar odds ratio. They're both highly significantly enriched. And then we see an even higher odds ratio for the reprogramming factors that were identified in the third mouse study. If we look at the TET2-associated CpG sites, we don't see this pattern. We see what looks like a mild depletion in the first case and then two non-significant depletions in the second two. So again, the two patterns seem to be diverging here. Because of the interesting reprogramming result, we also compared our methylation profiles to some previously identified differentially methylated regions that were associated with reprogramming, as well as two other sets that were associated with cancer and with tissue differences. And so what we see here is kind of jives with what we've seen earlier, which is that the DNA methyltransferase 3A CpG sites are very enriched for the reprogramming specific regions, and the TET2 sites are not. Among the other kinds of DMRs, they're both depleted for the tissue-specific DMR, which makes sense because it was generated by comparing liver, spleen, and colon, which is not that relevant to whole blood. And we see a slight enrichment for cancer DMRs among our DNA methyltransferase 3A results. Okay, and then finally, we did a gene ontology analysis to kind of take a hypothesis-free look at what kinds of genes are annotated to these sites that we're seeing as differentially methylated with CHIP. And so with the DNA methyltransferase 3A associated, and the gene ontology analyses, we performed these using a bioconductor package that was specifically designed to do gene ontology analysis for methylation arrays. And they perform a modified version of a hypogeometric test that accounts for the fact that different genes have different numbers of CpG sites annotated to them on the array, and thus they have different chances of being overrepresented. So to avoid that bias, that's what we used. So our results for DNA methyltransferase 3A, I'm not always great at interpreting these. I know that Casey Green on the first day said beware because everyone sees the same thing. Otherwise, other times you just see something that you can't understand at all. Here, it doesn't seem like either of those is happening. I don't see the networks that the paper Casey referred to included. I do see some terms mentioning things like development and wound healing and morphogenesis, as well as cellular processes. So this seems somewhat interesting. And then we did the same thing for the TET2 associated CpGs. And here, even I'm not a biologist at all, but here I look at this and it's really clear to me what's going on here. That everything is like immune processes or blood cells. And so these are clearly enriched for processes that are related to these downstream progeny of the stem cells, as opposed to the stem cells themselves. And so so now we're going to come back to our original, I'm probably almost all out of time, so we're going to come back to our original question, which is, how do these CHIP mutations lead to the self-renewal phenotype that we see? And this is, so as we were finishing up this project, we became aware of this interesting review article that proposes different models for how different CHIP mutations lead to this self-renewal phenotype. And for some genes that were better characterized in cancer, they had other models. But for this set of genes here, they proposed three possible models and stated it wasn't really quite known which might be at play yet. And so in the first model, the idea was that maybe getting the mutation enhances the self-renewal program. And so in this model, this particular purple cell, the giant red arrow means the self-renewal program is enhanced, so it goes on and makes lots of purple cells, and it starts to become clonally dominant. And the differentiation still happens. It's not impaired or anything, but it's kind of dominated by the self-renewal. The second model they propose is this one here. And in this case, the self-renewal isn't special at all, but the differentiation pathway is impaired. And so there's just going to be, the arrow that was dark here becomes light and faint here, and so there's less differentiation going on. That's a second pathway. And then the third mechanism they proposed was perhaps the mutations just kind of create more chaos. There's more epigenetic heterogeneity, and something else happens. And I didn't fully understand this third one, but that's okay because I feel like the first two really kind of describe what we've been seeing so far in our enrichment results, which suggests that the DNA methyltransferase 3 mutations appear consistent with enhancement of self-renewal, while the TET2 mutations are maybe consistent with impairment of differentiation. And again, just to summarize, our DNA methyltransferase 3 mutation was associated with decreases in DNA methylation near regions that were associated with hematopoietic stem cells and reprogramming, and with genes that were expressed in hematopoietic stem cells or involved in development. In contrast, our TET2 mutation was associated with DNA methylation increased near regions accessible in the progeny cells. So its loss means that we're kind of shutting down that differentiation pathway and genes that were involved in immune processes. And this is by no means equivalent to an experiment. It's all very suggestive, but I believe it does help complement in the experimental findings, and it seems to support the ones that are out there. And for example, most studies have recently shown that the knockout of the DNA methyltransferase 3A kind of immortalizes the hematopoietic stem cells. And that seems consistent with this model here where they get to just self-renew forever due to enhanced self-renewal. And so those are the conclusions that we have so far for this biological hypothesis. Before I end, I just want to touch on some broader conclusions. And as I said, one of the sort of overarching theme is that even without collecting additional data, we can ask some interesting questions that through just integration of the existing genomic and epigenomic data sets and taking advantage of these data resources, also through published results and summary statistics, this can allow us to answer new questions. And this is all possible through this movement towards open data, including data that's provided by key publications, which we took advantage of. And so this includes the raw data shared via GEO and other databases, and includes large projects like ENCODE and TOPMed. It also includes the summary statistics drawn from tables and data that you make available in your papers. And so if you want to increase your chances of being a key publication or a frequently cited publication, it's good to make this information available whenever possible. And so I encourage you all to both benefit from and be a part of this open data. And with that, I'd like to thank my collaborators. Here are my two key collaborators from the Broad Institute. There were also many great collaborators from the Cardiovascular Health Study and the ERIC Study, for which we also thank the participants of those studies, collaborators in TopMed in Charge, funding from the National Institute of Aging. Our preprint, which is also linked in the CGSI schedule, has our full collaborator list, as well as some analyses investigating additional questions that we didn't have time to talk about today. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention and answer any questions.